have to be okay, that's the point.
That's the best part.
Don't, I'm a psych.
I'm gonna use your mind.
Okay, great.
Is that cool?
What's up?
I just sent a text.
Oh, okay. I'll check in a minute.
I got to talk. And I sent y'all, I need y'all to make those.
Mr. Rogers.
I sent you some edits. Yeah, if you can send it.
Trayvon, okay, I downloaded the app. What do I do now? It's not one.
Give me 1 second. I'm trying to like reply to everybody's thing. Just give me 1 second. Did you create a profile?
Like you've been here for like years.
Okay, Aaliyah, can you help her with group? Are you in our group? Okay. You're not in our group.
Trayvon.
I think I just asked you.
I just want to could you introduce Dr. Jenkins to the I'm going to be right back. I'm
and delicate, perhaps a ladylike.
You know, like gotcha. If I walked a thick flight of stairs, not knowing where it was.
Mm-hmm. There they are.
Just
Yes, I do. For our class, I think the past.
Before the committee 70, just make sure you sign the clipboard circulating, and the last person you sign is hold on to it for the year today.
How did you go to class on that? Tuesday? How was it? How was that? She started. I do not have a father, my mother. And so we were stuck for a second.
Can you all see that in the back?
It's a little unclear.
A little unclear?
Yeah. I could also just see a minute of problem.
Oh, I can't see.
Is that slightly better?
If we cut the lights out a little bit.
If you cut the lights out?
Yeah, can we get it a little closer?
Get it more, you want it bigger?
Yeah.
All right. Is that better? Okay, I'm just gonna.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming out today to hear our guest speaker, Dr. Kenneth Jenkins. Dr. Kenneth Jenkins is a professor of African American and Diaspora Studies and a director of the UNC Center for the Study of the American South. Born and raised in Los Angeles, his family's roots in California go back to the first years of the 20th century. He was educated entirely in public schools and earned his bachelor's and master's degrees in history from Hunter College of the City University of New York and his PhD in American history from Rutgers State University of New Jersey. He is the author of three books, most recently, while he's here today, The Wilmington 10, Violence, Injustice, and the Rise of Black Politics in the 1970s, published by UNC Press. Thank you. And this welcome, Dr. Jenkins.
Good morning. Feels a little bit like afternoon to me. I still haven't quite gotten the, it's just a 1 hour time difference, but you know, that's all the difference in the world. I just want to start out by thanking African American Studies and Dr. Connors for inviting me, and Gerald Horn, who apparently is, you know, out of town and unable to be here today. It's an honor to join you all, and I welcome the opportunity to share my work with you and to talk with you over over the time we have about this work and about whatever other things you have questions for me, but I'm happy to try and, to answer them and to engage you. I will just, you know, say something about the biographical statement. You said that I grew up in Los Angeles and my roots go back there, and I just will say I'm kind of, up until I moved to Chapel Hill in 1991, I was really kind of itinerant. I moved around a lot, and when I got to Chapel Hill and got, to the South, which was the first time I really had a chance to have an extended period in one region other than where I grew up, I came to learn that place is something that is important to people and that they identify. So I've been in North Carolina since 1991, that's more than 25 years, and I can tell you that I am not considered to be from North Carolina, and my children who were born and have lived in the same house their entire lives, they are probably not considered to be from North Carolina, and I doubt if their kids will be. You have to, for good or bad, and I think there's both, you have to, have lived in that place for a long time, more than just a generation to be considered. So I started to, as a way to kind of talk to people about place, I figured, well, if I'm not from Chapel Hill, if I'm not a North Carolinian, I can claim my Los Angeles roots, and if you know anything about Los Angeles, you know that people are moving there all the time, and Los Angeles is a place where nobody is from. People just kind of come in, but my family has been there since the turn of the 20th century, so that's just by way of introducing myself a little bit. So thank you for inviting me, and thank you for coming out. And let me talk about the Wilmington 10. I'll take about 25 minutes, or perhaps a little bit more, maybe a little less. I also lived in New York and New Jersey, so sometimes I talk really fast. And so, who knows? It may be 10 minutes. If I go at North Carolina pace, it may be 10 hours. We'll see. So I want to talk about the Wilmington 10, about my latest scholarship. The Wilmington 10 was a monumental case of political repression from the 1970s. It was similar to other instances of egregious injustice of the time, such as the murder of Chicago Black Panther leader Fred Hampton by the Chicago Police Department with the assistance of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. It was similar as well to a legal frame-up of Angela Davis, And it was also similar to the Attica Prison Rebellion, which is the subject of a recent book by Heather Ann Thompson. With just a bit more thought, I think I could offer several other examples to you of the types of things that were going on in the 1970s. In the case of the Wilmington 10, the full force of the legal system hammered 9 young black men in their teens or early 20s and a white woman in her 30s for their part in protests over desegregation of the public schools in Wilmington, North Carolina. The actions of elected officials, police, prosecutors, and judges throughout the Wilmington 10's ordeals was callous and corrupt, even by today's standards of prosecutorial misconduct. So part of what I would like to do today is to rehearse the Wilmington 10 events and their frame-up. But it is also important to understand how the movement to free the Wilmington 10 developed and helped to define a new phase in African-American politics in which an increasingly varied movement coordinated its efforts under the leadership of a vital radical left. And I'll spend some time outlining this as well. As will become evident in a moment, I think, the name Wilmington 10 is in many ways a misnomer. Not only did these 10 persons not conspire to do anything, they also did not know one another or hang out together. They were caught up on a repressive machinery operated by the authorities, who were trying to suppress an expansive social movement, and in particular to place one person on the sidelines. So while I'll be talking about the Wilmington 10 as a single entity, because that is how the events are remembered in history, it is important that we understand that they were also 10 individuals. And I want you to know their names. They were Ben Chavis, Reginald Epps, Jerry Jacobs, James McCoy, Wayne Moore, Marvin Patrick, Ann Shepherd, Connie Tindall, Willie Earl Vereen, and Joe Wright. The immediate event that led to the Wilmington 10 was a boycott of Wilmington's recently desegregated schools in the first week of February of 1971. It was a boycott led by black students who objected to their mistreatment by school officials, who objected to the police who came to campus to stop fights, and white adult thugs who came to the schools to harass black students. They also protested their exclusion from a variety of extracurricular activities, such as cheerleading, sports teams, student council, and the like. The high school students issued a list of demands and established a boycott headquarters at the Gregory Congregational Church, which is affiliated with the United Church of Christ. And I will just say one thing about Gregory Congregational Church. Gregory Congregational was historically a black church. But by 1971, it was not exclusively a black church, and the United Church of Christ was if not unique, it was unusual in that it was a multiracial denomination, and blacks, and it joined together several different Christian traditions, both black and white. And Gregory Congregational, as I said, was from that tradition of was from the black church tradition, but it also had a minister who was white, from Hickory, North Carolina, Eugene Templeton. So it was a little bit unusual, and it was a reason that unusualness, if you will, was a reason that the church welcomed the students in. And became a boycott headquarters, whereas just about every other church in Wilmington refused to let them, refused to let the students meet at their church, and refused to offer any substantial assistance. Anyway, the boycott began in the first week of February of 1971. It was headquartered at the Gregory Congregational Church. A local paramilitary white supremacist organization called the Rights of White People, which had broken away from the Ku Klux Klan because it believed that the Klan was too moderate, had heard about the boycott and began to harass the boycotting students, including staging drive-by shootings at the church. So over the course of the week of the first week of February 1971, there were car caravans that drove by the church and shot at the church and shot at people and things like that. In response, the students and their supporters appealed for city protection, including asking for a curfew. But neither the mayor of Wilmington nor the chief of police of Wilmington was willing to oblige. Both of them said, things are under control the way they are, we don't have to do anything else. And when no protection was forthcoming, students and their supporters defended themselves by establishing a perimeter around the church and setting up armed sentries. Also in response to the attacks, unknown supporters of the boycott committed arson and other property damage against white-owned businesses and the nearby, previously all-white New Hanover High School Fieldhouse, which I came to learn was another word for gymnasium. It should be noted, however, that not all of the arson was in retaliation for the attacks. At least one business, Lum's Restaurant, was burned down by its owner, who tried to take advantage of the unrest in town to profit from his fire insurance. And a fire at another business also had suspicious origins. Among the businesses that burned, though, was Mike's Grocery, located a couple of blocks from the church slash boycott headquarters. It was a mom-and-pop grocery store owned by a Greek immigrant, Mike Poulos. I'll have something to say about him in a little bit. When Mike's was burning on the Saturday night at the end of the first week in February 1971, police shot and killed an unarmed student protester named Steve Mitchell. The next morning, a white supremacist by the name of Harvey Cumber drove through police lines and got out of his vehicle. As he prepared to shoot at the church, he was shot and killed by an unknown person, and that person to this day still remains unknown. With Harvey Cumber's death, the mayor and police finally decided that things were no longer under control, and they took action. They established a curfew. And at the city authorities' urging, the governor of North Carolina called in the National Guard and the State Highway Patrol. The Guard raided the boycott headquarters, and with its superior firepower, a sullen calm was imposed on the city. The students' boycott was suppressed. Students went back to school, but their demands were not met. That's what happened in February of 1971. 1 year later, in March of 1972, state and local officials, still smarting from the rebellion and determined to make someone pay for it, arrested 17 persons on charges related to the burning of Mike's and the murder of Harvey Cumber. 10 of them were put on trial in September of 1972 for conspiracy, arson, and shooting at the firefighters and police who responded to the fire alarm. Let me just stop here for a moment and talk a bit about what happened in that intervening year. The boycott was suppressed in February of 1971. the people who had called for the boycott continued to organize in Wilmington. They had established a local organization called the Black Youth Builders of the Black Community, which was an organization largely of high school students that modeled itself on the Black Panther Party. They established a church, a United Church of Christ affiliate called the Church of the Black Messiah, that modeled on a Black Christian nationalist church in Detroit to bring people in to worship and to develop a theology along Black nationalist lines. I thought it was interesting that in order to be a member of the church, you not only had to attend services on Sunday, but you also had to participate in a reading group. And so they read works by Frantz Fanon. They read, it was very clear in one person's mind that they had read Things Fall Apart by Chinua Achebe. They read works by Malcolm X. They read a variety of Black nationalist and Black leftist literature. And then in March of 1972, or by March of 1972, a radical Black nationalist movement had reached a point, not just in North Carolina, but throughout the United States, where there was a call for a national organization to figure out which way forward. And this was the National Black Political Convention in Gary, Indiana. And I can talk more about that in a little bit as well during the discussion. But things have reached a point nationally, I think, where there was an additional reason for state authorities to go after what happened in Wilmington, North Carolina. And I don't think it was coincidental that that the Wilmington 10, or these 17 people, rather, were arrested in March of 1972, as some of them, in particular Ben Chavis, had returned from the National Black Political Convention in Gary. So that was what was going on there. I think that, you know, I just offered that additional context so you can situate what happened, and you can perhaps begin to understand why the authorities did that in 1972 as opposed to a time earlier, that there was an urgency on the part of the state authorities to act. In any event, 10 of them were put on trial in September of 1972, as I said, for conspiracy, arson, and shooting at the firefighters and police who responded to the fire alarm. The prosecutor, whose name was Jay Stroud, based his case on perjured testimony that he himself had solicited and on an illegal process of jury selection in which he excluded practically all Blacks in the jury pool based on their race, and successfully strived to pack the jury with whites who openly expressed racist views or plainly stated that they had made up their minds that at least some of the Wilmington 10 were guilty as charged. And if you know anything about our legal system, defendants are supposed to have the presumption of innocence. The state has to prove its case that people are guilty. The people who are on trial do not have to prove that they're innocent. So, in this illegal process, the prosecution was ably assisted by the trial judge, Robert Martin, who also hogtied the defendant's attorneys. After weeks of testimony, the jury took only hours to convict, and the judge sentenced the Wilmington 10 to a total of 282 years in prison. So when I talk about the illegal jury selection process, let me show you what I am talking about here. Here we go. So this is what I had asked you if you could see earlier. These are the jury selection notes. There's five of them. These are the jury selection notes from the prosecutor. And they were discovered much later in the process. There was a grand jury hearing on this case in 1977. So the Wilmington 10 were convicted in 72. There were appeals. They were denied. They went to prison. And I'll talk about this again in a moment. The movement to free them was powerful enough to get the Federal Justice Department to call for a grand jury and look into the claims of prosecutorial misconduct. The prosecutors were told to turn over all their files on the case. And all their files apparently were turned over except for these jury notes, which were discovered probably around 2011 when the current district attorney was cleaning out a closet in one of his offices. And he found these and then turned these notes over to the Southern Historical Collection at the University of North Carolina, and where they are now on deposit and you can look at them. But these are the jury, the jury selection notes by from the prosecutor, Jay Stroud. You can see some of the things he says here. Stay away from black men. Leave off Rocky Point and Maple Hill, put on, because apparently African Americans who lived there were uncontrollable or unpredictable, but put on blacks from Burgaw, Long Creek, and Atkinson blacks. And then you look down here, and here are the notes of, so how am I going to do this here? Okay, here, I got it. Here are the notes that he wrote about the different jurors. So juror number one, Pridgen, is he in the KKK? He's good. He's good to go. Let's put him on the jury. And you go down here, juror number six, he's okay because he's probably in the KKK. And then you go down here to see where it says B there. So those are the black jurors. And he says here, Murphy is black, but he's worth a chance because he's from Atkinson. And then you go down to juror number 11, and he's black, Graham, and he's sensible and he's an Uncle Tom type, so we can put him on the jury. We can put him on the jury as well. And it's just more of the same. Am I talking too loud? Is that what he was? No. Okay, fine. You know, it's just more of the same. Here's jurors to leave off, you know, and so on and so forth. So you can see, this is it, you know, you can see why Jay Stroud didn't turn these over to the grand jury. And then you go to the next page, and I guess he's gotten a little tired because he doesn't put the names down, but he puts them on here. So here, juror number 31 is white because juror 31 doesn't have a B next to it, and this juror held up well, and he's prejudiced. That's great. And then, you know, you could just see this here. Some people, I guess, were of indeterminate looks. You couldn't tell if they were black or white, but you know, if they're white, they're in the KKK. If they're black, you know, who knows? You know, you can see all this stuff take off. And then possibly KKK, good, that's juror number 54. And we'll go down a page here. go down another page, more of the same. Ah, here we go. Okay, and this is a form that lawyers often use. It's the a schematic of the jury selection of the juror box, and people go in, and then you can make notes about them, and it's more of the same. But I want to point out to you, in one of them, I can't quite see which one it was. Here. Juror under number one, Mrs. Watkins. He wanted her off the jury because she referred to Ben Chavis as Reverend Chavis. He was a reverend. And rather than calling him Ben or Chavis, she called him Reverend Chavis, which would indicate that she had some type of respect for his position, and he wanted her off. And so there's more notes like this. And this, as I said, it says impression, no, exclamation point. And this is what I'm talking about the jury, the illegal jury selection process. Okay. So, and we can talk about this as well during the question and answer. So I'm going to put that down so that you're not distracted by that. Anyway, so after this process, they were convicted to 282 years in prison. And actually, let me stop just for 1 second and tell you a little bit more about this jury selection process. See if I can do it in 3 or 4 sentences. This is what the prosecutor was doing. What the judge was doing in all of this was enabling the prosecutor. So, if you go to trial and you're the defense attorney, you can challenge jurors for cause, or you exercise a peremptory challenge. In other words, you don't have to give a cause. You can just say, I want this person off. I don't like the way the person is dressed or whatever. You can come up with any sort of reason you want, but according to Supreme Court decisions, you cannot exclude somebody based on race. Most of the jurors that defense tried to exclude, they tried to exclude for cause. In other words, they argued before the judge that, John Doe, juror number one, was prejudiced, or John Doe had already made up his mind, or John Doe had family that was in the police department, and there's a conflict of interest and there's potential prejudice there. The judge always said no. And allowed these jurors to go on to serve on the jury. In fact, there was one instance, if you look at the trial transcript, where a juror is asked, do you think that the Wilmington 10 are guilty? And she said, yes, they must be guilty, else they wouldn't be on trial. And then, the defense said, excuse for cause. And the judge said no, and then the judge questioned the juror and said, can you set aside whatever prejudices you have or whatever preconceptions you have and just listen to the evidence? And the juror said, no, I think they're guilty. And he said, so it kind of went back and forth probably for about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and the judge would say, so you're telling me you will not listen to my instructions? No, I think he's guilty. And then went back and forth until finally the juror was browbeaten and said, yes, I can keep an open mind. And then the judge said, then you can serve on the jury and overrule the defense. So from the beginning, the case was stacked. That's my point here. And so they were sentenced to 282 years in prison total. And this might have been the end of the story. It was certainly the end of the story for other people who were arrested, tried, and convicted of alleged crimes arising from political protests. But almost immediately upon the Wilmington 10's conviction, and really before they were convicted while they were still on trial, there developed a vigorous multi-level and multi-dimensional movement to free them. It was built statewide at first, principally through the network of United Church of Christ congregations by that denomination's Commission for Racial Justice. It gained strength through the efforts of the Youth Organization for Black Unity, a radical black nationalist organization, and its newspaper, The African World, which had a national circulation. Many members of this organization were headed in the direction of Marxism, and a good portion of the leadership of this organization would end up in the Communist Workers' Party, five of whose members were murdered in Greensboro, North Carolina in 1979. It gained a national audience through the efforts of the National Alliance Against Racist and Political Repression, which was closely aligned with the Communist Party and had ties with labor unions and forward-looking public officials across the United States. And if you don't know what a labor union is, I'm not surprised, because most of the students in North Carolina have no idea what a labor union is. We're like the second to the least organized state in the country. So I'm happy to talk about that as well. In any event, and finally, the third organization here was the National Wilmington 10 Defense Committee, which was headquartered in Washington, D.C., that was able to draw in a variety of congressional staffers and ultimately was able to interest Amnesty International to take up the issue and label the Wilmington 10 prisoners of conscience. What I want to emphasize here is that this was a massive left-led movement that was international in scope. The Youth Organization for Black Unity, the Commission for Racial Justice, the National Alliance Against Racist and Political Repression, all had well-developed critiques of American society and capitalist society and the damage they did to African Americans and other racial and national minorities. They looked upon the case of the Wilmington 10 not as an aberrant miscarriage of justice, but as a typical, though perhaps extreme example of the way the system worked and the way the system was designed to work. They worked hard to link the issue of the Wilmington 10 with all manner of local issues facing communities in North Carolina and around the nation, showing connections between this particular instance of injustice and an educational system that failed African Americans, police forces that regularly traded in brutality, a criminal justice system bent on mass incarceration, an employer class set on exploiting workers more intensely by denying them the protection of a labor union, and a U.S. foreign policy that supported apartheid and colonialism in Southern Africa. And they were effective. They drew in thousands of people to demonstrations and engaged in political education, what used to be called consciousness raising. And they did it in community centers and workplaces and houses of worship around the country, and they brought into the fold all manner of people, including politicians and aspiring politicians and prominent public opinion makers. They finally compelled the President of the United States, Jimmy Carter, to become involved. And their pressure eventually forced the Fourth Circuit U.S. Court of Appeals to overturn the convictions of the Wilmington 10. Not on technicalities, as many people claim. So for example, when their convictions were overturned, the story that went out was that the prosecutor in the Wilmington 10 had framed guilty people. And the problem was they used some illegalities where they didn't need to, because they were guilty anyway. The U.S. Court of Appeals, though, took a different view. It didn't say that there were technicalities that were violated. It said that there was substantial prosecutorial misconduct and judicial misconduct. So there was the prosecutor who did things that they shouldn't have done, and there was the judge that did things that he shouldn't have done, and this resulted in a frame-up. This was a moment in history when the left in African-American politics was strong enough to lead a united front. Insider politicians, such as Joy Johnson, who was a reverend and was, the second African-American elected to the state legislature in the 20th century. Joy Johnson and Nikki Meshaw, who is still a leading member of the state legislature, they flocked to the movement because they recognized its power and because they felt that they might have been swept aside had they had not. They would have been irrelevant had they not gotten into this movement. This new type of politics was ascendant until the 1980s, when for a variety of reasons, it was suppressed to be replaced by a political class that was more in tune with the rules and regulations of a two-party system. And I would just like to leave you with this thought, that this was a movement that was led by a radical left, that moderates felt compelled to join. They didn't feel compelled to distance themselves from it. They didn't feel compelled to say, I repudiate it. They felt compelled to join it or risk their irrelevance. And as I think about what is occurring today, I think that without saying that the history of the 1970s is a prescription from today, is a prescription for today. I think there is a lot to learn or understand about that movement and how it might inform decisions today. So thank you very much. And I'm happy to have whatever questions you care to have for me.
Anybody have any questions? Mr. Rogers?
The last statement you said was about how this movement became the first leftist black movement that created like a united front. And then you said that lasted into the 80s because of like how a new party, how a new group of politicians understood like bipartisan politics. So do you think that if I used to close in the end, when you look at things like Black Lives Matter, do you think that it's the two-party system that kind of disallows for a united movement?
Like well, let me kind of back up a little bit. It certainly wasn't the first left-led movement. I think that there has been a long tradition, you know, certainly from the early 20th century and maybe, you know, the late 19th century of left-led united fronts. So populist movement of the 1890s, the movement, industrial union movement in the 1930s. So I wouldn't say that was the first. And I think Black Lives Matter, and I assume you mean as a movement as opposed to a hashtag. I mean, it seems to me that I think it's mixed. And I think there certainly was an effort on the part of Democratic Party politicians to co-opt it. And I think within that movement, among the more prominent personalities in it, I think that there was an affinity or a desire to be co-opted. I think about the number of people, say, who were advocates of charter schools or Teach for America, which, to my mind, you know, is a way of gutting public schools. So yes, I think it's kind of mixed, and I think, you know, in many ways it's too soon to tell. I think there's a lot of contention. I think there's a lot of contention in there, and I don't think it's a, as near as I can tell, it does not seem to be a unitary movement.
I think this person had their hand.
So I wanted to ask about sort of what I'm hearing in the narrative arc of the Wellington 10 is the beginning of the boycotts was sort of a contestation of of interpersonal anti-blackness, like the exclusion of students from extracurricular activities. And then sort of as arrests happen and people are unfairly confined, the sort of movement around them shifts to a more of a contestation of structural anti-blackness or the capacity for the law to set up the framing with prosecutorial misconduct. So I was wondering if you could sort of talk about what you think is the utility of that shift in the sort of full-scale advancement or contestation of anti-blackness in the criminal justice system.
Well, you know, I think that's a really good question. The history of school desegregation in the South, and I'm most familiar with North Carolina, but I think it holds true throughout the South, and probably the North and the West, all over the country as well, is that school desegregation, when it was carried out, was always, it seemed that it was, if it was always carried out reluctantly, and always carried out, or mostly carried out, in a way that put the entire burden on minority students. So if we're talking here about the desegregation of, if we're talking about, black, white, which is what I'm most familiar with, it was mainly, to the disadvantage or disability of African-American students. I think that's a structural issue from the beginning. I think the way that the students experienced it may have been personal. So for example, one of the Wilmington 10, Connie Tindall, was by all accounts among the greatest among the greatest high school football players. When the black high school was downgraded to a middle school, and he had to go to a previously all-white high school, he couldn't get a starting position. And, student body president from that high school, couldn't get into student government, So they experienced it as a, they experienced it personally. But I think it really was a structural issue. What I think is significant about it was that there was leadership from the very beginning in the struggle in Wilmington to take those personal issues and put them in a political context. The United Church of Christ, the Commission for Racial Justice, and Ben Chavis, and those other organizations that I mentioned, had a presence either at the beginning or very early on that could place those injured feelings in a in a structural context. So I wouldn't separate it and say it's either this or that, but I think it was the ability to elevate those grievances to show the boycotters what was going on, that made a difference. And that was not the case in other places. So quickly, in Pitt County, which is not far from Wilmington, there was a new high school that opened up, which was designed to be a consolidated high school. It was designed it opened up in 1971, and it was designed to accommodate both black and white students. There were very similar problems at that school as what was I described in Wilmington. At one point, there was a trash can fire in the boys' lavatory, which the rights of white people took credit for, but which the authorities went ahead and arrested 11 black high school students. And forced out a false confession from one of them, which then implicated all the other ones, and they were sentenced to, 130 years in prison. And then one of them was sentenced to 40 years and was offered to, and the prosecution offered to cut his sentence in half if he gave up his appeal, his right to appeal. So he served the full 20 years. The difference between the two was that in Pitt County, there was no leadership there to help elevate this. And so nobody remembers the 8 and 11. They just kind of, disappeared in the, they just disappeared. I couldn't find any of them. And that's the difference, those grievances, the injured feelings, the students' demands went from, we want relevant speakers to we want better food in the cafeteria to, just kind of ran the range, but nothing was ever systematized because there was no sustained leadership there. You had a question, yes, sir.
First, I have two questions. How involved might the other national African-American-oriented organizations been during this time frame, like SNCC or CORE or NAACP?
Okay, well, SNCC was pretty much, I think by 1971, was pretty much consumed by whatever internal disagreements. I think they were not a factor there. CORE was not really a factor. The NAACP, the students in Wilmington distrusted the NAACP. The leader of it was a doctor who was really quite comfortable and otherwise would have nothing to do with African Americans from the background that the 10 were from. Connie Tindall's dad was a dock worker. Wayne Moore's mother was a factory worker, things like that. They didn't really, there was no connection there. They were part of an isolated or self-isolated class. The Southern Christian Leadership Conference was there. But the, this was after Martin Luther King's death. And the people I had talked with were saying, well, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, there was no there. There was no substance to it. And the leader of the SCLC in North Carolina was somebody who was addicted to action and theatrics, but had no staying power. He went to one place and did a lot of running around and got a lot of publicity, didn't really educate people. And then when people were exhausted, he pulled up stakes and went somewhere else. And so there was no accumulation of wisdom and no accumulation of experience.
How about the HBCUs? Because there are several in North Carolina.
Well, you raise a good question. The Youth Organization for Black Unity was there. That was founded at North Carolina A&T. It had people at, you know, members in at North Carolina Central, which is in Durham. It was involved in what was going on in Wilmington, at least in terms of publicizing it, and it brought together, you know, it was the glue, I think, or at least one of the glues in the state to help join forces. So they were certainly there. The Black Panthers from Winston-Salem, there was a very active chapter there. Some of the people from that chapter are still there and are in city government. Larry Little, Nelson Malloy, and others are still there. And they had some involvement, and they mainly publicized things in their newspaper, but they did not have the reach into the eastern part of the state from Winston-Salem.
My second question goes back to the things you had on the overhead, which had to do with, did they do jury selection kind of like we do now, where they send out the request to be a member and what have you, and then from there?
It was a little, well, I don't know. You know, the jury selection pool, the jury pool was drawn from voter registration records and the DMV. And, you know, I should have mentioned this. There were actually two trials of the Wilmington 10. There was one in June and then one in September. And the one in June, they got the jury selection process going. And for whatever reason, you know, I think it was probably incompetence on the prosecutor's part. And I say incompetence because he wasn't really paying attention to what was going on. And he might have been in early stages of schizophrenia. He died not long ago and had been diagnosed as a bipolar. Acting a little bit irrational. In any event, the jury, after a week of jury selection in June of 1971, it became apparent that the jury would be majority black because there were three jurors that were already seated and they were black, and the remainder of the jury pool was majority black. So it was a foregone conclusion that it was going to be a majority black jury pool, and it was probably because the prosecutor wasn't paying attention to what he was doing. And, you know, he wanted a white jury pool and didn't get it. So what he did is he pretended to be sick and went to the hospital and he pretended to be sick, and the judge declared a mistrial, which allowed, you know, a do-over. It was a mulligan, for those of you who play golf. I don't, but I know what mulligan means. And in September, the prosecutor had the assistance of a special prosecutor appointed by the governor, to help out with the jury selection and the trial, and got just the reverse. Got 10 whites and 2 blacks on the jury. And the 2 blacks were much older and I think much more reticent and retired. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I think this could be applied to the whole of the United States South and of the United States in general. But like when we think of like moments of real racial tension,
Wilmington is a name that comes up a lot. Like,
sure.
There's home of one of the most famous or infamous race riots. So in your, like, dealing with Wilmington and your research, what do you think it is or was about Wilmington in particular that makes it the site of such a frequent and major racial events?
Excellent question. You know, Wilmington in 1898 was the largest city in North Carolina. It was majority black. North Carolina was the, you know, as a state, had a very active fusion movement. In other words, it fused African Americans who were fighting for increased representation and more democracy throughout the state with disaffected whites. And Wilmington was, you know, so in 1898, disfranchisement and Jim Crow was sweeping the country. In North Carolina, there was a fairly stiff fight against that. And it was reasonably successful. It was reasonably successful, and the forces of white supremacy decided, you know, consciously to focus its attention on breaking that biracial coalition. And it succeeded. It succeeded in turning poor whites and kind of the middle strata of whites against people who had similar and, you know, if not identical, but broadly similar economic and political interests, and attached them to the elite whites, you know, the 1%. The effect that had in Wilmington was, so there was a race riot. There was an expulsion of African Americans from Wilmington. And the effect that had was that over the next 50, 60, 70 years, black folks were afraid to stick their head up. They were like turtles because, you know, the memory of 1898 loomed large. Not only were people killed, people were robbed of their property, people were exiled. In 1971, you know, it was a city that was growing, that had increasing ties to other parts of the state and increasing ties to other parts of the country. And in eastern North Carolina, there was a growing leftist and black nationalist movement that Wilmington became a part of. So I don't know that it has something particular, you know, that there was something in the water in Wilmington, but there was certainly a political tradition that people could draw on and could use to their advantage.
Anybody else have a question? Okay. Real quick, Dr. Jenkins, is there any overlap between the time period? Wilmington, is this the area that Michael Jordan grew up in?
You know, I don't think so. He might have been a child then.
I mean, he's originally born in Brooklyn, but I mean, his family lives in...
His family is in Wilmington,
his
yes.
Family
or was, yes. Uh-huh.
Right.
And he graduated from Wilmington High School, yeah.
Wilmington High School. Is there any overlap between this time period that you're referring to with the Wilmington 10 and what we're seeing going on in Monroe, North Carolina, with Robert Williams?
Mm-hmm. Well, Robert Williams was in the 60s, or the 50s and 60s. This is in the 70s. I don't think there's any, you know, overlap of personalities. But I think there is certainly an overlap in political traditions and the spread of knowledge, you know, from one place to the next. You know, so people who were influenced by Robert Williams, you know, were living in Greensboro, and Ben Chavis was influenced by him, and he was from Oxford, and later moved to Charlotte, and then later moved back to Oxford, which is, you know, north of Raleigh. So yeah.
And do you think this movement has any impact on current day criminal justice reform, and looking at how we do things in this country?
It should. I think that, you know, the thing, but unfortunately not. I mean, the things, what the prosecutors did then, I mean, at least in North Carolina, the prosecutors do now on a fairly regular basis. They plant evidence, they go after people who they know are not guilty. There is an urgency to just find somebody. And in, I think what was different about that in Wilmington was the political, you know, it was part of a political, a movement of political repression as opposed simply to, you know, to convict somebody. But, yeah.
This thing,
thank you. These are great questions. By far, the best questions I've heard in a long time. Well, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for coming. We have some books. Yeah, go cool. We have some books here. Some of you all have purchased books, so I'm sure.